Right, I'm just want to check you can see the screen. You should have something up that says hacking humans. Yep, great. Okay, wonderful. Okay, so we'll dive into this and take a break part the way through. First of all, I'm going to just start off with a few quotes. There's a guy called Kevin Mitnick, who's one of the best known social engineers of times, and he says, the key to social engineering is influencing a person to do something that allows a hacker to gain access to information or your network. And Frank Abagnale said, there's no technology today that cannot be defeated by social engineering. And a guy called Barton Gellman says, social engineering, the fancy term for tricking you into giving away your digital secrets, is at least a greater threat as spooky technology. So I'm Trevor Wood. I'm a director of Network Midlands. I'm a computer hacker. I'm a cybersecurity researcher and a website developer. I'm a postgraduate researcher at De Montfort University, and I'm studying for my PhD in cybersecurity at the moment. So let's have a look at a few scary stats just to start off with. By 2025, it's estimated that cybercrime will cost the world $10.5 trillion every year. And they also reckon that in 2022, the cost was $6 trillion. Every 39 seconds, there's a new attack somewhere on the web. And last year, there was a 270% increase in social engineering attacks. 95% of all attacks are caused by human error, and 83% of all cyber attacks start with phishing. A majority of this is actually believed to be funded by organized crime. And so if we can reduce the number of attacks and reduce the amount that it costs, not only will we increase profitability for UK and worldwide businesses, we'll actually reduce the assets for organized crime. So I'll take a quick skim through what we're going to cover. First of all, we're going to look at why we fall for socially engineered attacks and how malactors collect information. Then we'll have a look at the different forms of social engineering and a bit about how these attacks can be mitigated. And finally, we'll gaze into the crystal ball and have a look at some future trends. But first, I want to show you a video. This is an opening sequence from a TV series, and I'm reliably informed that all the magic done in this series is actually magic. It's not camera trickery. So take a look.
Deception. Let's start with something simple. Pick a card, point at it. You know what? Reach out and touch the screen. Got it? Good. Now, imagine your card in your mind while I make it disappear. See? Your card is gone. You like that? Good. Because we're just getting started. You see, there are two kinds of deception. There's this, where I trick you. And then there's the other kind, where you trick yourself. I mean, we all do it. Today is going to be better than yesterday. Is it? Or that argument that you had with your friend, it was all their fault. Was it? And of course, my personal favorite. I don't need to go to the doctor. I'm fine. Go to the damn doctor. You see, our minds deceive us every day. They bend reality to make it be whatever we want it to be, whatever we need it to be. Or simply to make it all make sense. Even when it doesn't. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm Cameron Black.
We're coming to you live from Las Vegas! This is Deception.
And we'll see the point of that a little bit later. But what is social engineering? Well, the online dictionary lexicon says it's the use of centralized planning in an attempt to manage social change and regulate the future development and behavior of a society. Or in the context of information security, the use of deception to manipulate individuals into divulging confidential or personal information that may be used for fraudulent purposes. One of the best tech websites around, TechTarget, says it's an attack vector that relies heavily on human interaction and often involves manipulating people into breaking normal security procedures and best practices in order to gain access to systems, networks, or physical locations, or for financial gain. But actually, my favorite is this one. Social engineering is the clever manipulation of the natural human tendency to trust. So normally when I do this face to face, I ask you to shout out what you might think the first documented account of social engineering might be. But that's a little difficult online, so I'll go straight through it to it. It's actually Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden, right in the beginning of Genesis, where Eve is tempted by the snake to eat an apple that she's been told not to eat. So how did the snake do it? It started off by telling a lie. Are you sure that God said you don't eat this? Second one is to question God's motives as to why she shouldn't eat it. And then to say, actually, you're missing out on something really good here. Another one we all know about is the Trojan horse. The war is going on in Troy, and Odysseus can't get in. So he builds this wooden horse and actually persuades the Trojans that it's a gift from an Athena. And they take it into the city, but it actually contains soldiers. And when it's taken in, the soldiers get out and attack and open up the gates, and in comes Odysseus and the rest of his army. So why are we vulnerable to these sort of attacks? Well, let's have a look at some times when we see social engineering, because it's all around us. Marketeers, if anybody has worked in marketeering or knows marketeers, they use social engineering all the time. The same with salespeople, because they're trying to persuade us to buy something. Politicians do it because they want us to vote for them. Filmmakers do it because they actually want us to believe in something that isn't real. And of course, as we've already seen, magicians do it. Let's go back and see what Cameron Black has got to say.
An illusionist, like myself, uses deception to entertain, inspire. Criminals, spies, they use those same skills to steal, to cheat, perhaps even to murder. Now, the very best, well, they'll make you think that there was no crime at all.
So let's go back and have a look at some of the reasons why we're actually vulnerable to these types of attacks. The first one is human error, where people click on links that take them to phishing or malware sites, or they supply info that can be used to create these spear phishing or whaling attacks, and generally not recognizing when we're being attacked. And there's some psychology behind it. In our brain's job is to filter, interpret, and present us with reality. And I have a friend who maintains that there's always at least one more reality in the room than there are people, because we each have our own reality, and then there's one that we all share. But inside our brain, there's the reticular activating system, or the RAS. And this is a gatekeeper, and it filters information that goes into our conscious mind and selects only what is important and allows that in. But it can be programmed. So, for example, if you're looking to buy a new car, say you want to buy an Audi, all of a sudden you see Audis everywhere. Our emotions get involved here as well. And we'll see some of these get used by marketeers in particular. The first one is greed, I must have it, or urgency, I must have it now. Curiosity, oh, this is new, what is it? Fear, if I don't have this, I'm missing out. Self-interest, I'm going to have this so that somebody else can't have it. But then there's also helpfulness. And we'll talk a little bit about that one later. Daniel Kahneman came up with this thing called thinking, fast and slow. And he divided it into two systems. System one is our fast, automatic, frequent, emotional, stereotypic, and unconscious thinking. It happens quickly, and there are things we don't think about, like determining if an object is closer than another, or locating the sound of in a room, or completing a phrase like war and we'll all go peace, or displaying disgust when seeing a gruesome image, solving a simple arithmetic, 2 + 2 = 4, reading text on a billboard, or even driving on an empty road, and understanding simple sentences. But he also has system two, which is slow, effortful, infrequent, logical, calculating, and conscious. Preparing yourself for a start of a sprint race, assuming you're an athlete, which I'm not, and I haven't run for anything in years. Direct your attention towards somebody at a loud party, and you're looking for somebody in particular, or looking for a woman, say, with grey hair. Trying to recognize a sound. You've heard this sound, but you're not quite sure what it is. Count the number of A's in a certain piece of text, or park in a tight parking space, where you're determining the price-quality ratio of two items like washing machines, or determining the validity of a complex logical reasoning, or solving a complicated maths equation. So he decides to divide the brain into two. So as I say, you have the intuition, involuntary, effortless, innate skills, speed, reflex, happens like that. The other side, patience, concentration, constructive thoughts, analytics, effort, and reason. We take time over. We think about it. It's conscious. The American military, a military strategist by the name of John Boyd, was looking at how fighter pilots make decisions in a dogfight. And he came up with this thing of observe, orient, decide, act. And it happens very quickly, but it's a conscious process between one and the next. Malactors actually try to get us to cut out the observe, the orient, and the decide, and go straight to the act. So let's have a look at some psychological manipulation that you will come across. The first one is authority. For those as old as me, we were taught when we were kids to respect authority, like doctors and policemen. And if they tell you to do something, you do it. The second one is liking. If you like somebody, then you're likely to do something for them if they ask you to do it. Reciprocation. If I do something for you, you will want to do something for me. And one of the business networking groups that I've been to over the years really works on this. It's if I give you business, you'll want to give me business. Concession, it's sort of the other way around. If you do this for me, then I will do this for you. Commitment and consistency. If I can get you to commit to doing something, then you will do that. And that might be you've got to change your password every 12 weeks. And I want to check up on you to make sure you're doing that. Obligation is fairly similar. You're obliged to do something for me because somebody has told you you've got to do it. And then there's social validation. This is where all your friends seem to be doing it, or business associates or influencers saying this is a good thing. The final one, and one that is used a lot by marketeers, is scarcity. If you don't buy it now, you won't ever get it. There are a few other factors than the psychological reasons. They're practical. And the main one is that organizations don't have policies to help prevent attacks. Or if they do, they're poorly understood or enforced. An example, during lockdown, a charity that I know, somebody in their finance department received an email saying this invoice was overdue. and needed to be paid now or they were going to be taken to court. And although he couldn't find the original invoice, he went ahead and paid it anyway. They didn't have the procedures in place to check. They do now. If he can't find the invoice, he'll go to the finance director. If the finance director's not there, then they've got other things that they will do. But that costs them £27,000. One of my previous clients from before lockdown nearly got caught with a similar one, which would have cost them £250,000. So how do malactors get information to start these attacks on you? Well, the first thing they do, they look at open source intelligence. And social media is a good place to start looking, like LinkedIn, Facebook, or Instagram. Facebook, we see all these theories on there. The car you passed your driving test in was, or how far do you live away from your place you were born? Your porn name is your middle name and the first car you had, or asking where you got married or when you got married. These are all things that social engineers can use to build a picture of you and what your likes and dislikes are. They can go to Google. There's loads and loads of information there that people can find out about you. They can even go to Companies House if they want to find out about a business. And for a small outlay, they can find the names of the directors, they can get all the financial information and such. They can also get information about you from other people via phone calls or email or even face-to-face. So given all that, there's these people out there collecting all this information. How are they going to use it? So we'll have a look at some types of social engineering attacks. We'll start off with online attacks. And the first one that we all know about is phishing. And that's the fraudulent practice of sending emails purporting to be from reputable companies in order to induce individuals to reveal personal information such as passwords and credit cards. They might be trying to get your bank or PayPal account logins, perhaps by sending you a password reset. Now, Google have actually put together a short quiz where you can test to see if you have got to see if you can test how well you can spot a fake email and a real email. I'll make these slides available afterwards if you want, so that you can go to this place and try it out. So that's phishing. The next one is spear phishing. This is much more targeted. This is more like this invoice is overdue. It's sent to a particular person. And it often looks really legitimate. Involves a lot of research to identify the correct person to send it to and such like, but can often be worth a lot of money. You know, if you could do a lot of research about one person and get them to pay an invoice of £250,000, that time spent will be well worth it. The next one is called CEO fraud. It's also known as business email compromise. And it's where the company email accounts have either been spoofed or have been hacked and compromised. And it looks like you're getting something from somebody senior in the company to set up a money transfer or to buy some Amazon vouchers or something like that. Then we have vishing and smishing. This is phone calls and SMS messages, very similar to phishing, and designed to instill fear, uncertainty, and doubt, usually in the form of urgency and panic. Sorry about the motorbike just going past, if you can hear that. So some examples include, and we've all come across these, the Microsoft help desk phoning up saying there's errors with your computer. The BT internet, your internet connection, there's a problem, it's been hacked, or there's viruses. Or maybe a government agency doing research into what companies do about cybersecurity. Is it real? Or is it somebody trying to get information out of you? Legitimate enterprises like banks and such like will never ask you for your password. They'll never ask you for your PIN. They'll never ask you for all the information that will be needed to fill in one of these things. The next thing they try is using various different types of malware. The first one is scareware, which tricks you into paying for fake removal of malware. The malware doesn't actually exist. Instead, you're conned into buying and downloading a software that then fakes the removal of that virus. It may, and we'll talk a bit about that later, it may then actually install some malware on the system. And we don't actually see so much of it now, but there were some really famous ones a few years ago. So the next one is ransomware. And this we've all heard about because it locks your computer. You might have been conned into downloading it and installing it with some scareware. And we all remember the WannaCry attack on the NHS and other targets worldwide. This was a massive, massive attack all around the world. And the NHS took ages to get recovered from it. But not all attacks are online. There's some offline ones as well. There's pretexting. And that's where the malactor lies to you to gain access to privileged information. And they can actually present plausible reasons for you to supply that information. For example, staff have got to change their password every 4 weeks, somebody phoning up pretending to be from the help desk might want to pretend to be checking that you're changing your password by asking you what your old one was, what your new one was, and when you changed it. Actually, the film Catch Me If You Can, Frank Abagnale that we spoke about earlier, he pretended to be, amongst other things, an airline pilot to get free tickets. And if you can watch that film, that's a really good film. And Kevin Mitnick, I also mentioned earlier, his book, The Art of Deception, has got many, many examples that he used in pretexting. The next one is baiting, is where a physical device loaded with malware is left lying around. And the idea is to try and get you to insert it into a computer. Actually, the Trojan horse was the original baiting. And Stuxnet, I don't know if you've heard of it, Stuxnet, but this was a virus allegedly put together by the CIA and the Israelis, by Mossad, during the first Gulf War to try and destroy the nuclear reprocessing facilities. And what they did was put a virus onto a USB, hopes that somebody picked it up and put it onto the network, because the network was air gapped. They couldn't hack into it. And it actually worked. Go and have a look up. It's a really, really fascinating story. The next one that we see is diversion theft. It's where the malactor actually tricks a courier into picking up or dropping off a package from the wrong location. So they can either deliver a false package or get hold of the real one. And while it's not computer-based, it does use technology. And the US Federal Emergency Management Agency websites list some really high-profile attacks that were using diversion theft. So quid pro quo, this is the where the malactor either offers to provide you help, let me help you, or ask you to help, can you help me? Causing you to feel obliged to assist. Kevin Mitnick used to call with offers to help with real or faked IT problems. And when he sorted it out, he asked for something in return. It might have been the name of the manager of the department so that he could then talk to them about things. Honey traps, probably the best known in the world of espionage and politics. But they're now frequently online and often with dating sites and known as romance fraud. And we've seen a real rise in these recently, where people have given scammers hundreds of thousands, tens of thousands, in some cases even hundreds of thousands of pounds to somebody they've met on a dating site. Tailgating is also known as piggybacking, and that's where somebody follows a person or a group through a secure access point, relying on your kindness to hold the door open for them, particularly if they're carrying something. And you know, so can you just hold that door, please? One of the commonest, and I've seen this happen, is to join a group of smokers outside of Target built and enter with them when they come in. So we're nearly halfway. We're about halfway through. So I'm going to take a break now. You can go and recharge your beers and whatever, and we'll come back in, what, how long, Alex?
Sorry. Because we've broken a bit earlier. So should we say 8:15?
Yeah, 8:15.